The question is that the words proposed to be omitted stand part of the question. I call the Honourable Member for Gippsland.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. And I've come to this debate today with an open mind. I must say from the outset the government has failed to convince me at this stage as to the merits of its proposed legislation. And it may shock the Parliamentary Secretary at the table, but there are a few basic principles I try to apply when considering any legislation before the House. And to begin with, I tend to accept the premise that the government has been elected to govern. I respect that view of the people of Australia in 2007, and I don't try to be deliberately obstructionist in that regard. And where the government has a clear mandate for action in relation to its specific policy positions that's presented to the broader electorate, I tend to accept the view that it has a right to pursue that agenda. And it may not be a fashionable view among all on this side of the House, but it's a view that I tend to support. And it's not to say, though, that the opposition should vacate the field, and it most certainly must hold the government to account, and that is what I think the opposition is trying to do in this regard. It brings me also to a couple of other principles I try to apply in relation to my consideration of any legislation, and that is that the legislation must be, I believe, in the best interest of the people of regional Australia before I support it, and certainly needs to be in the best interest of the people of Gippsland, who have sent me to this place to get the best possible outcomes on their behalf. So it's in this regard that I do have some serious doubts about the legislation before the House and its capacity to deliver benefits for the people of regional Australia who choose, obviously, to live outside our main cities. And I've followed this debate with interest, and I would like to pick up on the commentary of the Member for New England earlier this morning. Now, I must admit I don't always agree with the Member for New England, but there were parts of his contribution which I thoroughly supported. And the Member did indicate that the development of a national broadband network is critical infrastructure that has the potential to deliver enormous benefits, particularly to regional areas throughout the rest of this century. And he made the point, and I think he made it quite well, that where you live will become less relevant in terms of your capacity to do business or to access health and education services in the future. It's a point that others have made on both sides of the House, and including the Leader of the Nationals, who spoke quite strongly on the issue earlier this week. But the word potential is where it tends to get bogged down, Deputy Speaker, and where my reservations arise with the legislation before the House. I'm not confident that the government has the commitment to deliver for regional communities. When it comes to telecommunications infrastructure, Gippslanders have no reason whatsoever to trust this government to act in the interests of regional Australians or Gippslanders in particular. And the evidence has been all to the contrary. We all remember, Deputy Speaker, the $2.4 billion Future Fund, which was meant to be kept in perpetuity to invest in improved services in regional areas. The Rudd government has stolen that money from regional communities, it's been absorbed into other programs, and it's gone. It's never to be seen again in terms of its intended purpose to assist regional communities. Over the years of the previous government, there were some improvements to telecommunications services in regional areas. But if you believe those opposite, the previous government did nothing. It did nothing anywhere, for anyone or anything. And that's a juvenile attempt, I believe, to dismiss the legacy of the previous government. It simply doesn't wash with the Australian public. No government, not even some of the appalling state governments we have at the moment, deliberately set out to do nothing. Work with me, Parliamentary Secretary. No government sets out to do nothing. We may always want more, but the Australian public expects the government members of the day to move past these very juvenile attempts to rewrite history. The Howard government did deliver on many fronts. In my electorate, there have been some improvements in terms of mobile phone access over the past decade, but it does remain one of the biggest issues within my community. The additional towers that were established under the previous government's Black Spots program and allowed extended coverage throughout many parts of Gippsland have made it possible for service to be delivered to some of my constituents where companies would never have justified servicing on a purely commercial basis. This effectively subsidised coverage has improved safety in my region, and as the Parliamentary Secretary well aware, in terms of their most recent bushfires, the coverage in emergency situations is one of the most critical issues for us in the electorate of Gippsland. And I do reflect on that point, Deputy Speaker, on the need for improved mobile phone coverage in the future in terms of emergency services coverage. I've already spoken today in relation to the new early warning system for natural disasters, which I give credit to the government for undertaking with a $15 million contribution, I believe, to Telstra to pursue that agenda. It is timely that the minister who's been involved with the bushfire reconstruction effort is in the chamber, because I believe it's important that we go the next step in terms of the new national warning system, that I understand in the first stage it will be able to deliver messages to landlines, voice messages to landlines and text messages to mobile phones based on their billing address. But I believe in the future, to deliver the real benefits to locals and visitors to Gippsland, the system needs to progress to the next stage of delivering text messages to mobile phones based on the actual location of the phone at the time. And that is the aim, I believe, that the government is pursuing, and I understand the state government and the state and federal government are both keen to pursue that as future stages of the agenda in terms of the national early warning system. It is a real challenge, though, and unfortunately many of the areas in my electorate where the mobile coverage is poor are also those areas that are most exposed to the bushfire risk. So I have sought additional funding from the federal government to deal with some of these black spot issues going forward. There are areas around the Latrobe Valley, some of the areas which were directly impacted on by the bushfires of Black Saturday and the earlier fires and the Delburn complex in the Ballara area. There are areas right around Latrobe Valley where, remarkably, for small towns within only probably 5, 10, 15 minutes of major Latrobe Valley centres, where the mobile phone coverage does drop out. And there are difficult issues to contend with. Further east, we have the geography providing many obstacles to improve mobile phone coverage. But we're going to have to deal with that difficult terrain, and we're probably going to need to subsidise those services in the future to those areas if we're going to improve community safety and get full benefits out of any national early warning system. I've written to the Minister for Broadband, Communication and Digital Economy in relation to this issue in the past. And I must say, Deputy Speaker, the response I've received gives me no confidence in relation to legislation before the House today and the ongoing issue of telecommunications services to regional areas, whether it be mobile phone coverage in this instance or the future national broadband network. In his response to my concerns about the township of Mallacoota, which is one of the towns identified as a bushfire priority risk by the Victorian State Government, the Minister wrote to me, and I quote, "The Australian Government appreciates the importance of mobile telephony to Australians. However, the decision to provide mobile phone coverage is primarily a commercial matter for mobile phone carriers. In making the decision to extend coverage to a particular area, a mobile phone carrier will consider a range of factors, including site availability, cost structures, likely levels of demand from users, and overall economic viability of the service." That message is fairly clear, I believe, Deputy Speaker, that it is primarily a commercial matter, and the Minister has no intention of implementing a black spots program to assist in that regard, which I think draws us to the very point of the legislation before the House today. In terms of the issues facing regional communities, that with the rollout of the national broadband network, with mobile phone coverage rollout, the carriers themselves will quite naturally go to where the profits lie. And I fear that there'll be people at the end of the line, if you like, who miss out completely, and that is my greatest concern with the legislation before the House today. So I don't want to pretend for a second, though, Deputy Speaker, that I'm some sort of Telstra cheerleader, and I'm not going to stand here and pretend that everything is fine in regional Australia or in my own electorate of Gippsland. And I'm not going to even try to defend Telstra's record, particularly under the reign of the previous Chief Executive. I think there are some appalling lack of judgment at times by Telstra in relation to its handling of its regional customers. But I'm a realist, and I want to know that under the government's plans, that regional areas will actually be better off. Those opposite have attempted to ridicule speakers from this side of the House who have sought to delay the progress of this legislation to make sure we do get it right. And I do have a great deal of sympathy for that view of delaying it till we get it right. The government doesn't have a clear mandate for this policy position. Only a few months ago, the Minister was quoted as saying he had no intention of forcing such a separation upon Telstra. And this has never been put before the Australian public. To the best of my knowledge, it's never been Labor or Coalition policy. Having said that, Deputy Speaker, I'm not as hardline as perhaps some others may be about the broader issue of structural separation. I do believe we need to take steps to drive competition, particularly into regional areas. Telstra, as I mentioned previously, hasn't always behaved appropriately in terms of the best interests of its regional customers, and I'm hopeful that the new CEO, David Thodey, is keen to address that situation. I had the opportunity to meet with Mr. Thodey earlier this week, and I was heartened by his comments and his attitude towards his regional customers. I believe that we may see a change of direction in that regard. I have been very critical in this chamber in relation to Telstra's handling of the user charge they applied to their customers with a $2.20 fee for paying illegal tender across the counter at various agencies, and I believe the point that I made to Mr. Thodey on the day of that meeting was well taken in that regard. I believe that Telstra may take a more charitable view of its customers, particularly older customers and those in regional areas in the future. But having said that, Deputy Speaker, there are areas where it will never be commercially viable for companies to invest in regional services, and that's where I believe the Future Fund was designed to assist, along with the universal service obligation. Deputy Speaker, as I indicated, I can see some merit in the position to help drive competition, but the process undertaken by the government must be appropriate to the circumstances. And I fear that the government has held a metaphorical gun to the head of Telstra and its shareholders. Those opposite have discounted the arguments put forward in relation to the impact this decision will have on shareholders of Telstra, and I'm not suggesting for a second that the interests of shareholders has to be our primary concern in this place, but they most certainly should be considered by us as responsible legislators. More than 1 million mum and dad shareholders will be affected by this decision, and it's flippant, I believe, and irresponsible for those opposite to just brush that issue aside. Deputy Speaker, it concerns me that we really don't have a complete understanding of all the issues in relation to this legislation. And the reason we don't have a complete understanding is that the government simply hasn't done the homework. Well, if it has done the homework, it certainly hasn't taken the people of Australia into its embrace, if you like, and to explain exactly what's intended. I refer to a question in the House earlier this week where the Leader of the Opposition asked the Prime Minister for more information in relation to the national broadband network. And I must say it was a very pertinent question, Deputy Speaker, and I quote from the question. How does the Prime Minister justify urging Australians to buy bonds in the $43 billion national broadband network, assuring them that those bonds would be a good investment, asserting that the national broadband network would be commercially viable and claiming its services will be affordable when the Finance Minister and just a moment ago the Treasurer have admitted that all of those statements were made without any business plan or cost-benefit analysis? In other words, without any reasonable or responsible basis for believing those statements were true. Now, in his answer, the Prime Minister, as he often does, sought to deflect attention to everyone but himself. He came out swinging, of course, in relation to the National Party. He said, "The National Party in particular surprises me because so many Australians out there lack high-speed and effective broadband services." No disagreement there, Deputy Speaker, but under his own plan, so many Australians will also continue to not receive high-speed broadband services, and the Prime Minister failed to mention that there's actually no business plan in relation to this $43 billion national broadband network. I fear that the government is flying blind, and it troubles me in relation to the legislation before the House at the moment. As I said at the outset, Deputy Speaker, I'm not interested in being obstructionist just for the sake of it, but I do have considerable reservations and support the need to delay this bill until the NBN implementation study is presented to the Parliament. After 2 years of delivering absolutely nothing except empty promises in this regard, we can't afford to wait for the findings of this $25 million study that the government has commissioned. I believe the House will be better informed in that regard with the findings of that study before it. Deputy Speaker, the government is asking me and asking other members to take what I believe is an enormous leap of faith in this regard. They're simply saying, just trust us, everything will be okay. Sure, we don't have a business plan for the $43 billion NBN program, but you can rely on us. Well, I'm sorry, Deputy Speaker, I don't have that much confidence in this minister or in the government. We've already seen the NBN network, the National Broadband Network, change remarkably in terms of the promises being made by this government. At first, we had this fairy tale about delivering fibre to the node coverage to 98% of Australian homes at a cost of just $4.7 billion. I think the Australian community should have signed up straight away on that one. I think they were conned. Now the new promise is coverage to just 90% of homes at a cost of $43 billion. But we really don't know where that figure of $43 billion has come from. It looks to me like it's just been some sort of stab in the dark, a best guess. There is no business case or infrastructure plan that I've been made aware of. And the promise, Deputy Speaker, has now been downgraded. It's been downgraded to the extent that it excludes towns of less than 1,000 people. There are more than 1,000 towns, as I understand, in Australia with less than 1,000 people in them, and many of them are in the electorate of Gippsland. I mentioned earlier that the NBN has the potential to deliver even greater benefits to regional areas than anywhere else, but many of the towns in Gippsland are simply not on the government's radar, let alone on the government's national broadband network plans. In all good faith to my electorate, I can't support this proposition at this stage and urge the government to wait until the implementation study is presented to the Parliament. Deputy Speaker, one other aspect I'd like to touch on is the confusion over the future of the universal service obligation under this bill. And I take up the issue raised by the Leader of Nationals in this regard. He highlighted that under this bill, the legislated universal service obligation is abolished and will be left to the whim of the Minister to decide which services are provided. I don't believe this is good enough for regional areas. We've already seen the whim of the Labor ministers at work with the removal of the $2.4 billion future fund, which is an enormous betrayal of trust with regional communities. Before I can have confidence that this bill is in the interests of regional Australia, I'll need more information from this government in relation to its broadband proposals and how it intends to deliver those services to rural and regional communities. There is a lot at stake, as many people have indicated in the contributions to the debate before the House. There is a lot at stake for regional communities because we have the most to gain from improved telecommunication services. The tyranny of distance is one of the main factors holding back the growth of regional communities, and technology has the capacity to overcome a lot of those barriers. I believe that rural and regional Australians have every right to expect better telecommunication services in the future in all its forms. And as the Leader of the Nationals correctly identified, a robust communications network will have a range of applications in regional Australia, both social and economic. It will create better health services, better education, greater employment and business opportunities. And I do urge the government to take the time to get this right. Finally, Deputy Speaker, in the time allowed to me, I'd like to refer to a media statement today from the Shadow Minister for Broadband, Communications and the Digital Economy. And in his media statement, the Shadow Minister said, and I quote, "Since coming to office, the Rudd government has already abolished the $2.4 billion communications fund established by the Coalition for Telecommunications Upgrades in Rural and Regional Australia, cancelled the $2 billion OPEL project, which would have seen fast and affordable broadband services delivered throughout underserved rural and regional areas this year, and is winding back the Australian Broadband Guarantee Program, which provides subsidised services for Australians living in underserved areas. This government already has a dreadful track record and should not be believed when it says it is acting in the best interests of rural and regional Australia." Deputy Speaker, that just about sums it all up for me. The government has to prove its bona fides to regional Australians before it can reasonably expect us to support this bill.